Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Economy and Fair Work Committee of 2022. Our first item of business is a decision to take item 4, which is our annual report, in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. So our second item of business continues our evidence gathering session for Town Centres and Retail Inquiry. I welcome our first panel, who is Derek Shaw, Director of Innovation and Place from Scottish Enterprise, Douglas Cowan, Director of Communities and Place, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and Brian McGrath, Director of Enterprise and Place, South of Scotland Enterprise. Welcome everybody this morning. As always, if members and witnesses could keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, that would be helpful. I'll just start with a general opening question about the Town Centre Action Plan. And I'd be interested in each panellist's views on how their agency will be supporting the Town Centre Action Plan, what they see their role as. If I maybe come to Douglas first and then Brian, and then I've got an additional question for Derek. I'll bring Derek in at the end, but Douglas, if you'd like to go first.
Thank you. I guess Highlands and Islands Enterprise has long had a communities remit as well as a business support and economy remit. We see town centres as really important to our economies, to our communities, kind of underpinning much economic activity, including tourism activity. We support a number of businesses across the Highlands and Islands, many of which are located in our town centres. We work with around 130, 140 social enterprises in a bit of depth. Again, many of them are place-based organisations, some from a town centre perspective, many others more rural and island locations. So we'll continue to work with businesses and community organisations who are active in town centres where they are delivering economic benefit and social benefit for us. Mm-hmm. We have been involved over the years in a number of, I suppose, specific regeneration projects, if you like, across the Highlands and Islands. And we've probably a number of examples I could go into now or touch on later.
Okay. When we come back later, I think other members will be interested in some of the examples. Brian, if you could maybe respond, and could you say anything about the new action plan, which is a refresh on the 10-year, since we passed the 10-year point. Is there ideas or proposals in the new action plan that you think will make a difference, that you welcome or think need expansion?
Yes, Convener. From a SOSI perspective, we're really focused on places. From our inception, we've taken places as the heart of our approach, place-based approach. So town centres as the heart of places are really, really important in that context. And so that's really helped shape how we approach this particular topic and this particular issue. We're also, as you know, focused on working with businesses and community organisations, and I think that's a crucial message in this context. And of course, it comes through strongly in Town Centre Action Plan that in order to move forward, it's about collaborating, it's about working in partnership, and certainly everything that we've learned so far in the short life of SOSI has been the centrality of partnership working, and already SOSI is working very closely with the councils, with the local authorities, particularly in terms of how we look at supporting town centres regeneration and places, individual places. But we also work with the third sector interfaces and the third sector, and we're conscious of aiming to support businesses in town centres as well. But I think we definitely come back to that thought that what we're trying to do is support the place, because if the place is prosperous, if the place is has a sense of well-being, and the community in that place has that sense of well-being, then the town centre will have that vibrancy, and the town centre will reflect that good position. So we're currently getting our heads around the new Town Centre Action Plan and how that how we can feed into that. But we've SOSI itself and Our chair, Professor Griggs, helped feed in directly to the Town Centre Review Action Plan Review Group, and we have a sense that the action plan has a lot of really logical key steps. But at a regional level, at a local level, for us, it's about that partnership. It's about that real partnership on the ground that can make a difference.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And Mr. Shaw, we do recognise the different role that Scottish Enterprise has in relation to the other two enterprise agencies in terms of supporting town centres and retail. It'd be helpful if we had an understanding of where Scottish Enterprise engage with the retail sector, perhaps more than town centres. There is Lindsay Methvin is on the retail strategy steering group from Scottish Enterprise. So we have an understanding of what kind of support you provide to that sector and how that can support town centres.
Sure, thank you, conveners. I think my colleague Neil Francis was at the committee a couple of weeks back and outlined Scottish Enterprise's approach to retail. That's not changed. We very much believe that there's a number of business support stakeholders at play, including Business Gateway, that adequately and appropriately support retail. In terms of town centre regeneration, it's about our focus on supporting businesses and supporting business growth. Often those businesses are located in towns and cities, and as a consequence of that growth, that leads to employment and sustainability within towns. Very much focused on infrastructure and place, like Brian indicated. So we have a dedicated place team working in partnership with regional stakeholders, community stakeholders as well, including community planning partnerships and regional economic partnerships. So very much focused on how we can work with stakeholders in a particular place to benefit that economy and provide solutions and opportunities for that area, which then has a positive impact on towns and local cities.
Okay, I'm not quite. So the Retail Strategy Steering Group for Scottish Enterprise have a role on that. What do they bring to the table? I don't quite understand how that matches to what you've previously
said. So my colleague Lindsay, as you said, is on that steering group. I don't have information at hand specifically about our role, but I would be delighted to follow up with the committee in written response as soon as possible if that's appropriate.
Okay, thank you. There was, we did have Community Scotland. They came to an end in 2008. So, you know, we do recognise Scottish Enterprise has a different role, but the role that South of Scotland and Highlands and Islands are playing in those parts of the country, who is playing the equivalent role in the rest of the country? Because we do understand it's not Scottish Enterprise, you have a different remit. So who is it, do you see? Is it local authorities? Is it a combination? I know Brian's talked about partnership working. Is it?
I think it's a combination. So local authorities, other stakeholders in the regions. And as I said, we very much have a regional and partnership approach. We have dedicated senior leaders within Scottish Enterprise that are allocated to the seven regions within our area and work with partners, including the local authorities and leadership groups, to identify, develop and then hopefully deliver opportunities, economic opportunities specific for that area.
Okay, I'll hand over to Colin Smith to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, Colin. Thanks very much to the panel for sharing your views today. Can I come back on that point to Derek about the different roles Scottish Enterprise have compared to your colleagues in the Highlands and Islands and the South of Scotland? Douglas said in his opening comments the Highlands and Islands have always had that community remit, and Brian will know that I spent many, many years calling for a similar agency in the South of Scotland, because I was struck by the fact that a business in a town centre could receive support in Inverness, but that same business couldn't receive support in Dumfries. Now they can, because we have the South of Scotland Enterprise. Do you think that but you know, the challenge I've got now is that a business in Ayr can't get the same support as a business in Dumfries because of the remit that Scottish Enterprise have. Do you think that puts Scottish Enterprise at a disadvantage when it comes to providing support for town centre businesses?
No, I don't think it puts it at disadvantage. There's a number of support mechanisms in play, including within Scottish Enterprise and our partners in Business Gateway, who provide a very comprehensive support to a range of businesses, including locally trade businesses and professional services businesses in local areas. We are an economic national economic development agency, so very much focused on opportunity-driven strategies, place-based strategies at a national level, but in a regional context. In terms of individual companies, yes, we don't tend to support retail, but we support a number of other companies that have growth ambitions and can contribute to town centre economies and regional economies as well, and very much from an account management perspective have a wrap around support, bringing expertise, financial support to the companies that we work with.
What kind of businesses? So if I'm walking down my high street, what kind of businesses are Scottish Enterprise supporting on my high street?
So we support SMEs with employees of more than 10. We support large organisations that are both Indigenous to Scotland as well as companies that are looking to locate and invest here. So very much focused on companies that have got growth potential and are going to make a positive contribution to the economy. And significantly, where Scottish Enterprise can add the most value in that particular context. So if there are other partners, other stakeholders and other organisations that are better placed to support companies, then that we would view that that is their role. We've also got the Find Business Support Service that is an online tool that's available to all companies in Scotland that offers advice, support on all the public sector support that's available to companies, and that's a really quick and efficient way for companies to access information that they need when they need it.
So that support's available obviously to every single part of Scotland, but if you look at the projects supported by Highlands and Islands and South of Scotland Enterprise, we visited recently, for example, the Mid-Steeple project in Dumfries, very much a community project. That would it be fair to say that's a project that wouldn't be able to get support if that was an AIR, because it would be up to Scottish Enterprise to provide that support rather than South of Scotland Enterprise, who have that community remit?
I don't know the details of that particular project.
Just in general point, so you don't support projects, though, that have that more community-directed remit?
We support, for example, through our Cooperative Development Scotland, which is part of Scottish Enterprise that works with organisations, works with companies to look at how we can increase employee ownership, and the performance of that is very good in terms of the number of companies that we've supported that's then transitioned to those new business models of employee ownership, and I've got some examples that I'd be happy to share with the committee.
Okay, that'd be helpful. Can I come to Douglas and Brian? Obviously, because of that community remit, you're able to support projects that could be argued are not going to make huge profits, but actually are hugely important to the regeneration of our town centres, attracting people there actually to support other businesses. But how do you ensure that when you provide support, and if I can ask Brian, maybe just even about the example I mentioned there when we visited the Mid-Steeple Quarter, how do you ensure that the support you've provided is linked to ensuring that becomes a financially viable project in years to come, and it's not just a project that maybe we'll keep coming back to look for funding?
I think that's one of the crucial challenges that are faced in relation to many or all of the type of capital projects the committee saw, Mid-Steeple Quarter, and there are quite a lot of other projects across the south of Scotland that want to make similar improvements, but the real challenge, as you highlight, is that ongoing viability and sustainability, and one of the new things that SOSI has brought forward in the south of Scotland is that focus on what we call enterprising communities, and one of our teams is actually focused on working with communities, not every community group, but those groups that can demonstrate and we can help build their capacity to become enterprising. It's that challenge of where can a revenue stream come from, where can that, how to move that really good idea and that ambitious idea to take to find a new use for a building and actually bring that forward and make it something that's viable over the longer term. So with Mid-Steeple Quarter, as well as working closely with the council and Scottish Government and Holyrood Trust as the key funders around the capital project, we've also been helping the organisation think about its business plan and think about how it's viable into the future. And actually it's a great example of a pilot project, of a demonstrator type project, because it is a test and we will have to see if it works out. But actually that's the fundamental across all of the capital projects that we want to help support that will transform towns and villages in the south of Scotland, is that it's only going to work if those projects keep on going and don't fail after they've been running for 2 or 3 years. And we think that's a shift in thought process and a shift in the thinking of how these projects are developed. And actually, we might have to say, no, this project isn't going to work. We can't see where that revenue stream is. So let's try and reshape the project. Let's try and find a different end use for that key heritage building that we're looking at. And for instance, we in Whithorn, the new town hall in Whithorn is another project that Sosie's been involved in, and Sosie came into that project quite late on to help support and actually have helped that community group reshape the project and find some different ways of generating revenue to help make that project more viable into the future.
So that's very helpful, Brian. So on that point, Douglas, I mean, Sosie are very clear that the funding's linked to working with them to make sure it's financially viable. Is that an approach that the Highlands and Islands Enterprise take, and those projects that are not obviously going to make lots of money, but you do link that funding to making sure they've got a plan to deliver that financial viability?
Yeah, absolutely. Long-term sustainability is a key issue in diligence around projects. And I agree with much of what Brian said and approach. One of the things that we do and have done for some time is we provide early support to communities. So we are, alongside Scottish Government, are funding, I think, around 40 local development officers in communities, and that's communities that are developing sometimes significant projects. So that is almost in at the early start. So there's a paid resource to help work on business plans, look at viability issues. Sometimes these projects will actually deliver the capital project, but sometimes actually the viability and sustainability isn't always there. So the capital funding won't come through. So capital funding is very much related to long-term sustainability. Now, I guess we can never ensure that these projects will be sustainable, but I guess before capital funding is awarded, it needs to have a reasonable, a good prospect of being sustainable. And that applies to not just community projects, a whole range of projects that we're involved in.
Okay, sure. I'm sure my colleagues have got other questions on that, but I'll be cut off by the convener.
Okay. I think Colin...
Thank you, Convener. I've got a couple of areas I'd like to explore with you. Looking over the evidence that we've received during this particular investigation, derelict land and buildings in town centres has consistently come up as a problem. Now, Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise have never used the compulsory purchase powers granted to them by the 1980 Enterprise and New Towns Act. I'd like to ask why not, and I'm going to go to Brian first because I'd like to just check that South of Scotland Enterprise also have these powers that's mentioned here.
No, I actually part of the bill process had that very discussion, and it was agreed at the time that wasn't necessary, and that Sosie would be seen to work really closely with the local authorities in its area if that compulsory purchase process was required. So that would be the approach that we would take in the south of Scotland. So that is different to the powers that the two other enterprise agencies have.
Yeah, it's good to highlight that. I'll turn to Derek actually now and ask him that question. Why have you never used the powers? Do you think they should be used?
Well, you're absolutely right, Deputy Convener, that we do have powers over compulsory purchase, but we very much view those powers as an option of last resort. So we've been very fortunate over the years that we have been able to agree favourable terms for Scottish Enterprise and the taxpayer for land or buildings that we are looking to purchase. And as an economic development agency, we're very much focused on delivering jobs and investment. But where that aligns to objectives around regeneration of brownfield sites and dedicated land to achieve our place outcomes, then that is absolutely great. But we have no overarching objective to tackle vacant and dedicated land, but we can absolutely make a meaningful contribution to this through the delivery of some of our strategic projects. And an example is Halo in Kilmarnock, or indeed Dundee Waterfront, where there has been significant investment. We also own a significant portfolio of land, and some of that has been legacy operations, and we're very much focused on looking at our strategic priorities and identifying where that land, and that vacant and derelict land, and in some occasions can be brought back into economic use and regeneration in areas that absolutely need it, but aligned with wider strategic priorities, including low carbon. So it's a focus certainly of my team within Scottish Enterprise to ensure that we are using our portfolio of land in a strategic way, and likewise where there's opportunities to purchase land, where there's demand for it, then that's certainly an option that we undertake through our capital funding.
Can I just clarify a statement you made earlier where you said that you had no plans around derelict and derelict land and buildings? Is it that it's not on your radar unless it comes up as part of a project or that you're looking at? Or is it something that's part of your long-term strategic plan? You seem to be indicating you're not really taking it into cognizance at all.
Apologies. We absolutely are taking it into cognizance in relation to the land that Scottish Enterprise own. And we are looking at various different strategies and how we can bring that land back into economic use. Some of those options involve Scottish Enterprise taking forward development of our land portfolio. In other occasions, it's working with private sector partners who may be interested in purchasing land from Scottish Enterprise. And there's a number of examples over the last couple of years where we've either sold vacant and derelict land, which has then went on to be developed, or indeed where we are in the process of looking at how we can develop it ourselves.
Perhaps I can ask Douglas about Highland and Island. How are you treating compulsory purchases, and what's your plan for derelict land and buildings?
So, firstly, on compulsory purchase, I think I'm right in saying we've never used our compulsory purchase powers either. Much like Brian has said, I think our approach is very much a place-based approach. It's working with communities, working with other partners across our geography. We've got eight area teams covering our geography who are detailed knowledge of what's happening across the patch. We've never seen the need to use compulsory purchase powers to deliver economic community development that we've been delivering. We've managed to secure any assets required through negotiation, through working with partners, working with other stakeholders.
And yet community representatives that come in front of us have said how important it would be for compulsory purchase powers to be used in order to bring these properties into some sort of commercial or other use.
We've never seen the need to use CPO powers for, you know, there are derelict buildings in many of our towns. Our primary support is working with businesses and working with specific community organisations to deliver their social and economic outcomes. We've never seen the need to use CPO powers specifically for that.
Derek, can I come back to you on that particular point about where the community groups have been indicating that there is a need to use compulsory purchase as part of the regeneration of town centres. Do you have any views on that? Do you think it's something you should be involved in?
I think ultimately the remit for Scottish Centre is the responsibility of the Scottish Government, but I think where there's an alignment with our wider strategic priorities as a national economic development agency, then there's a role for us to play. But if it's in relation to perhaps retail or town centres, I would suggest it is for other partners, including the local authorities, to take that forward.
So broadly speaking, you don't see a specific role for Scottish Enterprise in regeneration of town centres, other than supporting what the businesses where that's appropriate?
The responsibility for town centre regeneration and sustainability moved out, and budget moved out of Scottish Enterprise several years ago into to the local authorities, so it's not currently our area of focus or indeed our remit, but absolutely where we can support businesses, and the wider impact of supporting businesses will hopefully have a positive contribution to town centres.
Let me move on to my second question, which is related to digital skills and expertise. E-commerce has become quite a big thing, and you know, there is a need for small and medium businesses to be able to be skilled in order to work in that area. Other digital skills, of course, are required as well. What are the enterprise agency's role in improving these skills and instilling confidence in these businesses to move into e-commerce and related fields? Brian, maybe I can ask you to comment on that.
Yeah, happy to, Deputy Convener. We absolutely recognise the importance of digital and e-commerce for the future of all businesses, actually, whether they're in the high street or not, but particularly important for retail and encouraging that mix of bricks and clicks, if that's the buzz phrase. We're actually really early early days in terms of our thinking about our actual support in this area. We're still shaping up our digital strategy and our digital approach, but skills will absolutely be part of that. But in the south of Scotland, there's already support through Business Gateway and the Digital Boost product that's available. That's available nationally, of course, and SOSI actually provides the Business Gateway service in Scottish Borders on behalf of Scottish Borders Council, a different solution in Dumfries and Galloway. And of course, really, really important role that the colleges, the two colleges in the south of Scotland, play, Dumfries and Galloway and Borders College, in terms of those digital skills. So we work with the colleges and the councils as part of a team south of Scotland partnership that helps to look at skills and other issues across the board. It actually feeds into our regional economic partnership that we've established.
Perhaps I can ask Douglas what's happening in his area.
So there's probably two key elements to our work around digital. The first one's actually around digital infrastructure. So we delivered the DSSB broadband rollout, which is now finished, just the contract works clearing up across the Highlands and Islands, £140 million contract that we kind of led. And we're continuing to work with Scottish Government on the R100 programme and UK Government on the gigabit rollout. So we see the digital infrastructure as a key issue for the Highlands and Islands, where coverage is poorer than much of the rest of Scotland in many cases. So the digital infrastructure is a really important element for us. We recognise the importance of digital for our businesses and communities. I guess in terms of the business and skills side of things, again, I won't repeat what Brian said, but in addition to, I think, what SOSI have done, when COVID hit, we recognised that digital adoption across the Highlands and Islands was lagging slightly, again, the rest of Scotland. We put in place an initial £500,000 programme to support businesses with digital adoption across a whole range of activities. That was oversubscribed very quickly. We increased it to around £1.5 million. That was also oversubscribed. We managed to get another £800,000 from the Scottish Government, and we ended up with around £2.6 million project, which helped over 213 businesses with their digital adoption. And that, I think the programme's still live, although the funding has pretty much been utilised. There is now other funding in place. I think when we started up, there wasn't the digital loans, and I think digital boost wasn't quite there yet. So there's other programmes have come in since we entered that, but it's clearly had a big, big impact.
Did that specifically include e-commerce?
No, across a whole range of digital, digital skills, website development, e-commerce, a whole number of strands around it.
Derek, can I finally can ask you to give a comment on what's happening in your patch?
Absolutely. So Scottish Enterprise is absolutely focused on digital transformation and supporting companies around that, including e-commerce. We ourselves in our international arm, SDI, offers e-commerce services to help SMEs, both domestically and internationally. We have a digital transformation team within Scottish Enterprise, so a team of digital specialists who work with companies to offer advice and guidance around good practice around website design, analytical tools in terms of how they can get the best from e-commerce and their own website. The digital specialist within that team is trying to bridge the gap between a company's overall objectives in terms of what it is looking to do on revenue and sales growth, and how it can achieve that through technology and digital transformation, including e-commerce. We do have an international e-commerce programme that offers tools to businesses to trade internationally. And that programme is open to a range of companies, and from April 2020, 2,000 companies have participated in that programme. So it's an intervention that works really well for companies that are looking to expand internationally. But overall, our digital transformation team helps companies both domestically and those that are looking to expand abroad.
Just one final question. The figures I've seen are that Scotland has about 2% of the e-commerce business in the UK. How does that relate to the fact that all these companies are getting the training and so on in e-commerce? Why aren't we at a higher percentage in terms of that?
I think we probably need to do more, both in terms of business support for growth, in terms of how companies can trade internationally, looking at the support that we can provide through SDI around an exporting service, but also doing more around digital transformation and e-commerce to increase and encourage more companies to trade internationally.
I mean, I wasn't really talking internationally here. I was talking about the domestic market.
I think that equally goes for the domestic market as well, in terms of looking at opportunities within the UK and identifying those markets within the UK that companies are best placed to go after, and then working with them strategically through our account management service to build a strategy on how we can work with companies to achieve that, including through our e-commerce support.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Gordon MacDonald for a supplementary, and then Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, Convener. I've got two very quick questions that I wanted to ask, and I'll come to Derek first. There are 11,000 hectares of vacant and derelict land in Scotland, and over 79,000 empty properties. You've explained your views on compulsory purchase orders, but is there a need for compulsory sales orders to be introduced? And secondly, VAT arrangements on residential conversions. If we want to bring our town centres back to life, we want people to be living in our town centres, much of the vacant spaces above shops. VAT on residential conversions and adaptions is at 20%, whereas demolition and new build is at 0%. Is there a need for the UK government to address the VAT problem?
Thank you, Mr. McDonald. Could you just clarify the point around sales orders and what you mean by that?
There's been suggestions that there's a need for compulsory sales orders where land or a property has been lying vacant for a long number of years. There is the opportunity for an organisation like yourself to, or the local authority, to force the owner to put that up for auction, and it would be sold to the highest bidder.
That is not something that we have looked into in terms of that approach. I can certainly take that back within the SE and come back to the committee on our views on that, but it's not something that we consider to date. As I said, in relation to compulsory purchase orders, we've not had to use that because ultimately we've got good relationships with a number of developers and owners, and we've reached agreement on where we need to buy land or property on terms that are acceptable to Scottish Enterprise.
And any views on the VAT?
Apologies, I don't know.
Does anybody else want to come in on those two points?
If I go at both of these, if I may.
Right.
I think there maybe is a case for compulsory sale orders in special circumstances. There are a number of sites across our towns that are blight. Now, the mechanisms, the specific mechanisms and who these powers, who acquires are maybe a secondary question that I maybe don't have a view on, but... Yeah. I think there are blights in our towns that those kind of powers might help address. In terms of VAT, I think to regenerate our towns and cities, we need to create more diverse uses. We need to bring more people into our towns, greater footfall in our towns. Part of that is more housing. It's converting upper floors. Yeah. Frequently, it's also, I think, in some towns where there's far too much ground floor commercial space, it's converting ground floor space. Clearly, the market is not delivering that. The costs of that development are simply higher than the end values. Mm-hmm. I think that's possibly exacerbated by the needs around net zero and energy efficiency. And therefore, I think there are potential fiscal measures that could be used to balance the equation to some degree. And I would have thought VAT is one area that's worth looking at. There may well be others around maybe non-domestic rates issues. There's maybe other issues, other mechanisms, but VAT would certainly be one that I think would be worth looking at to deliver the outcomes we want to see.
OK. And Brian, I know you don't have compulsory purchase powers, but do you have any views on those two issues?
I actually think that compulsory purchase orders are a powerful tool, and it's about the ability and capacity of particularly local authorities to go through that complex process. But I think that's a really important tool in the armoury that probably does need to be used. More often in really sticky situations. I think that Douglas has used some good language there about blight and problem buildings.
Okay, thanks very much.
Yeah, thank you. Maggie Chapman, followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thanks very much, Claire. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning. I want to explore in a little bit more detail some of the issues around community and social development and how they are linked to economic development and how the economic development activities that you are all engaged in can support that. Can I ask, Derek, I'll start with you. How are you developing support for commercial enterprises with a for good mission, those specifically that have for good as their central cornerstone?
So I guess our remit is very much focused just now on delivering against the government's ambitions on the National Strategy for Economic Transformation.
we are appropriately plugged into a number of community groups, and as I mentioned earlier, very much proactive in our regional economic partnerships and the partnerships that we have got. We are very cognizant of the role that we need to play at a local and at a regional level, and indeed Scottish Government encourage all of the enterprise agencies to do so as part of a Team Scotland approach. Ms Chapman, could you just clarify the point that you were making and the question you've been asking there about...
Yes, so it's businesses, commercial enterprises that have a for good mission at their heart. How is it that you are supporting... How is it that you're focusing... any support if you are for them to enable them to develop and be commercially successful, but with the social and community benefits that they are seeking to deliver. Yeah.
I thank you for that. I think it's a really interesting model for companies and organisations to work with, and we have a range of support for companies that are operating that space to. How they can develop their business models to ensure that they are commercially viable. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, through that commerciality and the profits generated, then that can be reinvested into to a number of good causes that are supporting. We have a financial readiness team within Scottish Enterprise that is focused on working with companies to identify opportunities, identify funding opportunities, and... part of that process or that service is working with companies and organisations to look at their business plan and develop a plan that will secure investment, whether that's grant funding or commercial investment, and really looking at the best way of generating income and ultimately profit, and in companies that are focused on good causes then reinvesting that into the good causes that they support. So that is certainly an area that we are interested in and focused on.
Okay, thank you. Brian, could I ask the same question of you? Support for commercial enterprises that have a for good mission.
I think I take a slightly different tack, actually, mm-hmm. because, as I mentioned at the start, SOSI is very focused on a place-based approach, yep. and actually all of our support is framed in that context. So whether it's a business or a community organisation, a social enterprise, we actually, when we're working with that client and working and helping them think about their project, we're actually encouraging all of them to think about the economic, community and environmental impacts that they have and the benefits that flow from their work, starting to move towards that community wealth building, community well-being type of idea. And as you'd imagine, that's a challenge for my colleagues internally in the organisation to think in that really broad way. But that's something that we're working very hard to get that economic, community, environmental thought process for everything that mm-hmm. we do, and that fits really well back into that place approach. Yeah. So that's our push. And I suppose some of the for good. Drive is also reflected in community well-being, reflected wealth building and community ownership opportunities that are arising as well, community asset transfers, and, mm-hmm. and that comes back to earlier question about how can SOSI support that whatever that entity is to have a really viable business plan and to think about sustainable long-term revenue streams.
Thanks, Brian. You followed my train of thought into the community wealth building space. So thank you for that. Are there things within that space that we should we being the Scottish Government, being enterprise agencies, being all of us working together, that we should be focusing on slightly differently to maybe maximise the benefits that social and community groups and our town centres or the communities that live in and rely on them need?
I think, and I still haven't got them off the top of my head properly, but five pillars of community wealth building are a really helpful framework for that thought process. And I think, you know, SOSI feels like we're at the early days of our thought process around that. We've actually appointed a dedicated officer, a strategy manager for community wealth building, to help our form our thinking and help drive the agenda within the organisation. And I'd be really positive that quite quickly we'll get our heads really, really strongly around that. I think Fair Work was a new agenda 2 years ago for us, and I think we've made great strides there. So I'm very confident that we would actually be able to pick up on those thought processes and help weave them into what we do as an enterprise agency.
And do you think that will support the sort of resilience that we are wanting to see, not only in our local town centre economies, but also resilience more generally, and also the sort of circularity that we're able to deliver through the Scottish in the Scottish economy?
I think it has a real opportunity to add to that resilience of individual places, and as I said before, with that the town centre's resilience as well. If we can help that with that wider prosperity, and particularly for a rural area like the south of Scotland, being able to retain value in the economy and be able to recycle that within the economy is a really important principle that we need to aim for.
Thanks, Brian. Douglas, if I can come to you. There's a lot in there, but for your comments on community wealth building, for good missions, circularity, resilience, the whole lot.
Yeah, okay, I'll give it a go. So we've long had that community remit. Yeah. We've supported community asset ownership, particularly for probably in excess of 20 years. We currently deliver the Scottish Land Fund across Scotland, nationally with the Lottery Fund. So assets and land assets are probably two pillars of community wealth building. I think there's one around the plural ownership and actually supporting communities and supporting local ownership. I think is really helpful, really productive. It helps it circulate that wealth. And also, I guess, the socially productive use of land and property is another of the pillars, as I understand it. And again, supporting communities to deliver their own economic and social value of that landholding. And we've seen some of the big estate purchases in particular are really good examples of how that's worked. Golson, I think the north of Lewis maybe it stands out as a cracking example of that, but they're not alone. There are other good ones. So we've supported the asset side long, and that is a critical pillar of community wealth building. It plays into community resilience, communities owning assets deliver direct economic benefit, but also benefits in terms of services and what have you as well. So fully behind it, fully support it, and have been active in that space for quite some time. I guess the other angle is around the social enterprise space. So again, we've worked closely on social enterprise for many, many years. We work closely with the government in terms of the Social Economy Action Plan. We work closely with a number of clients across our portfolio. And I think a quarter to a third of our clients are social enterprises, many community organisations and community-based, but social enterprises. We see the real value, the economic value, but also the social and community value that they can bring, and indeed environmental value in many cases. Mm-hmm. So again, very supportive. We work with a lot of clients in that field. Yeah.
And what are the barriers for that sort of close working between yourselves and social enterprises?
What are the barriers?
If there are any.
I'm not sure there are. We deal with social enterprises and community organisations in much the same way as we deal with our business clients. Okay. Some of the outcomes are slightly different. We do adopt a place-based approach. So, again, maybe you look at some parts of the Highlands and Islands where there's a lot more social enterprise activity. In the Highlands and Islands, generally, there's more social enterprise activity, more social enterprises per head in the Highlands and Islands than elsewhere in Scotland. So we've got, a deeper base and maybe a longer time period base of social enterprises. So we don't really see too many barriers. They're there. Some of the outputs are they don't deliver the same outputs in terms of necessarily jobs and turnover, but they do deliver good local economy benefits, and they do help that circulation of wealth.
Thanks, Douglas. Derek, can I come back to you? Because I realised the conversation drifted into community wealth building and resilience, and you didn't give you the opportunity to pick up on those. Do you want to say anything?
Yeah, so in terms of community wealth building, we're on the government steering committee for that, so very much contribute into to the thinking around that. As I mentioned before, our Cooperative Development Scotland service is very much focused on working with organisations, with companies that are looking at employee ownership as a model that has been very successful in terms of the advice, the guidance on different structures. There's great examples of distilleries that, you know, have got 3,000 shareholders in the local community contributing to the success of companies. There's other models that we support in terms of cooperatives as well, and local businesses coming together, particularly focused on that local or regional market, and how we can support those projects and those initiatives got off the ground. So it's interesting in terms of the stats around cooperatives in Scotland, because I think overall within the UK there's about 12% of new cooperatives within Scotland. Compare that to a population of 8% and a business base of 6%. So we're certainly punching above our weight in terms of that approach and that model of both employee ownership as well as cooperative development.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson to be followed by Alexander
Burnett.
Sorry, there was going to say Stuart, but that's other Alexander, sorry.
Good morning. Thank you all for attending. I want to ask a couple of questions about women in enterprise and mindful of what you've been emphasising, Brian, in particular, in the concept of place and also in their place. And of course, their place is thriving, active, entrepreneurial bases with an equitable a number of businesses as to men contribute in place. So do you have an active strategy for women into enterprise just in general in your organisation? And within that, what do you routinely disaggregate data by women, and do you publish that strategy and that data, and how do you measure it? So just a bit of flavour about that. And if you don't have a strategy, just tell me. Derek, you smiled. You can go first.
Thank you very much indeed. So I guess approximately half of the participants in our entrepreneurship programme are female-led. Most of our programmes and our interventions are open to all. But this year we had dedicated three cohorts of our Principally Women programme focused on Aberdeen in the North East and in Ayrshire and Glasgow and Clyde respectively. We supported partners investing in women, Mint Ventures and Young Enterprise Scotland. So this is an area that we are absolutely focused in on in terms of our approach and our strategy, and collecting data around the support that we provide, particularly to female-led entrepreneurs. Our flagship entrepreneur programme, Unlocking Ambition, is almost half female among its participants, and it has actually been balanced in terms of gender since it was established several years ago. And looking at our high growth ventures, so our companies that have got real significant growth potential and that we work with on a very comprehensive and intensive basis, including through the provision of funding and investment, a third of those businesses are female-led entrepreneurs. There's absolutely opportunity to do more in this space in terms of the work we're doing on entrepreneurship and entrepreneurial activity.
but we're very much connected within relevant partners and stakeholders that are supporting female-led businesses and how we can work with them proactively to help them achieve their growth.
OK, thank you for all of that. And just a quick question before I move on to Brian and Douglas. Do you have a specific strategy for women, or is consideration and cognizance of women part of your overarching strategy?
I would say it's the latter. So okay. It's very much a consideration and a focus in terms of the support that we are providing, the type of companies that we are supporting, and how we can do more to encourage start-up and early-stage growth companies that are female-led.
Okay, so Brian, women in place and women in their place in terms of a full contribution. What's your approach?
Well, really, really, really important in the South of Scotland context, and definitely, I think a relative gap that we've seen, and so we don't have a strategy yet, but we're framing up our approach towards women in enterprise as part of our overall entrepreneurship approach. Which will have a focus on women in business, but also on young people as well. And we think we can bring something fresh and new to the table in the south of Scotland through that approach. We're going to use a coaching approach, which will feel slightly different to standard advice, but very much driven by experience in the team that we have. And I think we've also picked up and are working with other national partners. So, for instance, we've done some work with Weevolution, who are helping us target some community-level support for women in business. Through Business Gateway, we're trying to create a pilot startup program in Newcastleton for women starting business. So you can see it's small moves at the moment, but it's absolutely an important issue on our radar. And we're also looking at what we can do around more specific networking events as well, because we're conscious of in a sparsely populated rural area, how do we help link together people with similar interests and similar ambitions to help them move forward together and learn from each other.
Mm-hmm. And Douglas?
I don't think we've got a specific strategy around women entrepreneurship. However, it is a consideration of what we do. I guess if you look at our client base and the across the range for the clients we engage with, I think 45% are female-led. But if you look at our significant social enterprise cohort, 54% of them are female-led. We've got a number of programmes so one example, the two areas that we focus on is one, women into business and women entrepreneurship. There's young people, given, I guess, our demographic challenges across the Highlands and Islands. So one of the programmes we've got is in the Northern Innovation Hub programme is about supporting young leaders. And I think we've worked with about 100 young leaders. And of that cohort, 59% were women. We've also just recently completed a transnational pilot programme around rural female entrepreneurship with partners, I think, in Sweden, Finland, Canada and Ireland, looking at specific support that was targeted. Women only, using coaching, using online methods. I think it was live from maybe end of 2018 to the very end of last year. So it got impacted by COVID to some degree. Worked with, I think, around 70 women entrepreneurs in the geography. I think it was Argyll and the Islands we piloted that project in. Worked with about 70 women entrepreneurs with kind of positive economic outcomes. Wasn't universally supported by the client base. Some felt women only wasn't the right answer. I think the majority felt it was helpful. We've got, I think, to work through what the evaluation actually said and how that plays into what our strategy for support looks like going forward. But there's certainly some positives come out of that work.
You've probably led me on to my next question. When we had Caroline Curry in from Women in Enterprise, she made an interesting comment that our traditional measures around what constitutes a micro business, for example, she was making the comment that she's aware of a number of women-led businesses that are, by their very essence, micro businesses, but they've got significant turnover, and very often the agencies won't pick up that because there's a threshold by number of employees. And of course, where their turnover is significant, they are typically using e-commerce as a mechanism to trade, something else we also want to encourage. So my question is, are you aware of that fact, and have you reflected, like almost like back to front, how e-commerce can skew number of employees against turnover? It kind of breaks the usual measures that we might choose to adopt. And have you considered that in terms of women-led businesses specifically?
No, I think is probably the honest
That's
answer.
That's a very honest answer, yeah.
I think I recognise some of what you've said. I don't think if there was a business with significant turnover looking for support from us, we wouldn't discount it because it wasn't employing enough people. We could provide additional advice and advisory support, and maybe specialist advisory support in certain circumstances. I'm generally aware of the kind of issues, so I'm aware of a social entrepreneur on an island who set up a hub for online trading that it pulls together a number of small makers, I suppose, from across really rural areas, and has provided, an online e-commerce hub for that kind of activity. Yeah. As an individual, we have supported in the business we are working with.
So I think without leading you, it sounds like you're almost promising me you're going to reflect on that as you develop your women's strategy. Thank you. And how about Brian and Derek, just to finish off?
Interestingly, because of this place-based approach, we'll actually work with any business of any size, and it's about their the place context that they're in. Because in a really small place, a business that employs two or three or four people it can often be really important. So that's absolutely the approach that we take, and we're consciously trying to avoid thresholds and numbers of employees and turnover levels, because we recognise that the South of Scotland economy and the challenges in the South of Scotland need SOSI to have that really broad-minded approach.
Right.
Like Douglas, I think it's probably an area that we need to look at more in terms of companies that are generating significant turnover, but perhaps have not got the employees relative to the turnover that they're generating. I guess for Scottish Enterprise, our focus is around job creation, safeguarding jobs, creating more jobs, better jobs, greener jobs. So where there's an opportunity to work with companies, micro companies that have growth potential, not necessarily in turnover, excuse me, but in terms of employee growth, I think that would be our focus and our priority. If there's limited scope for job creation, it's going back to the point I made earlier about the wider support that's available to those companies. And some of that may come from Scottish Enterprise, but may not. And it might come from other partners like Business Gateway. But our primary priority focus is working with companies that have good growth potential and are going to increase their employee base in Scotland.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can I just ask a quick question before I bring in Alexander? It's to Derek. So one of the pressures we've seen for high streets is online sales. And it is a number of years since Scottish Enterprise invested in Amazon. I do recognise that's now quite old, that investment. But the focus from Scottish Enterprise on creating jobs and investment, obviously Amazon were an appropriate company to invest in, but they're one of the companies that have, you could argue, led to pressure on high street sales. Do you think, while the Scottish Enterprise's remit is different from other enterprise agencies, I think you've just said the overriding principle is still around investment and job creation. Is there any, is there an improvement in the kind of synergy between Scottish Enterprises remit and other things that government are progressing, such as the town centre retail strategy? The, you know, there's an agenda around town centres, and there's a decision made by Scottish Enterprise, which is now, I do accept, it's in Fife, it's 8 or 10 years old now, but that could be seen as having a direct negative impact on what happens in terms of high streets.
Yeah, so we don't look at things in isolation. So whilst our primary lens is job creation and economic impact, both at the regional and national level, we are looking when we provide support, whether that's advice or guidance, or whether that's funding through grants or commercial investment, we're looking at how much leverage we can get for that support and that investment. So, and it's not solely about jobs, although that's the primary lens. So looking at the place agenda, so where is that company investing? Is it in a location that is needing expansion, is needing growth opportunities? So looking at the supply chain. So if we are providing support to a large company, for example, what does their supply chain in Scotland look like, and how can we encourage that company to look at local suppliers here in Scotland? So it's looking at an integrated approach in terms of how we get the most for the investment and the support that we are providing, and we'll take into account a number of factors in doing so, including international, the types of jobs that's been created, the transition to net zero and how a company is aligning with that, fair work principles, what is the commitment companies that we are supporting are adhering to in terms of fair work. So we look at things in the round, and particularly around place as well. In 2018, in response to government's focus on place, we established a place team within Scottish Enterprise, and that is very much looking at how our interventions and our support has a positive impact on local areas. So in summary, I guess we're looking at things in a holistic way at a macro level, but through that primary lens of job creation and good jobs.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Alexander.
Thank you, Convener. Just for my question, just a brief observation. You know, the word place is mentioned a lot and bandied around a lot. Douglas, I see you're Director of Communities and Place. Brian, you're Director of Enterprise and Place. And Derek, Director of Innovation and Place. I wonder if there's a why there isn't any consensus of where place actually sits in organisations and responsibilities. But that's maybe just an observation you might want to comment on. My question is asking really, what are you doing to ensure economic opportunities are available to everyone in our towns, including older people and people with disabilities? We took some excellent evidence last week, and I'd just like to ask what economic assessment you do of these particular groups, where do you think the success stories are in your from your organisations? Douglas first, and then Brian and Derek.
Thank you. Equalities impact assessment is a key part of our diligence process. So when we look at it from the other end, we look at it with the businesses and community organisations we engage with and the projects they are delivering and what the equalities impact of that activity might be. So that is right in the middle of our due diligence process. It's there alongside our work on net zero and fair work. So it is very much a part of our process. I don't think we look at it from the other perspective, from the perspective of those with disabilities, for example, or certainly not from a town centre perspective as well. It's very much from the client-led perspective is the way we look at it.
Would you point to any particular success stories you funded or supported that others, I think, were sort of short of examples on the ground to direct people to? You could share some.
Struggling to think of any right now. Part of the cohort we deal with, though, is social enterprises, and many of them have got a specific remit and role to support or to provide different services. Some of those services provide to those in the greatest need. I guess maybe the other thing worth saying is that when COVID hit, we were at the heart of that community response to COVID. So we worked with our community anchor organisations across the Highlands and Islands to ensure that that funding got down from government through us to the anchor organisations to those in the greatest need across the region. So we've done a number of things. I'm not sure I could point to one specific example right now, but we could certainly dig something out and forward that if that would be helpful.
Yeah, thank you. And Brian?
I think it's a really good question, actually, and perhaps two parts to it, because as an enterprise agency, we're pushing forward helping businesses grow and provide employment opportunities, helping attract businesses into the south of Scotland, working with colleagues in SDI around inward investment. So there's the job opportunity element to that. But actually, we also work really strongly in partnership, as I mentioned, Team South of Scotland partnership with the two local authorities, with Skills Development Scotland, with the colleges. And it's actually those partners that have a really powerful role in terms of employability, helping upskill people, and helping provide that ability for people to go into these roles, which I think that partnership approach that really makes the difference. We, as partners, we keep a close eye on universal credit claimant count as well, which has that tracker of people out of work, but also people with various challenges about getting back into the employment market as well. And so I think that's an important element. And actually, in a South of Scotland context, we're seeing that the terrible impact from COVID-19 is starting to come. The pre-COVID numbers are starting to come back around to similar numbers now. But we know there's still lots of challenges about how we can help people into the job market. Actually, one of the projects one of the businesses we've supported recently is a call centre business who are actually providing working from home posts, which is something new in that kind of context, enabled by the changes that we've seen over COVID-19, and that part of that process has actually been for us to specify that it's people who've been furthest from the workplace that are eligible for those roles. So that's probably the territory you're thinking of.
So would it be fair to conclude that unless a business or an enterprise brings a project to you which improves economic opportunities for these groups, you're not actually actively looking for that?
I think as a partnership that we do very much have that focus on employability and those furthest from the workplace.
Yeah. Okay.
So Scottish Enterprise is very much a champion of the Fair Work criteria, which requires a commitment from grant recipients to reduce gender pay gaps and improve diversity and inclusion within the workplace. And we are currently working with 310 companies that are taking action to tackle gender pay and improve diversity and inclusion in terms of their recruitment processes. And we're working with in excess of a further 80 that have committed to do so. We've also led the development of the Fair Work Employer Support Tool, which has 90 registered users across Scotland from public, private and third sectors. And this is a tool that provides users with resources related to their development needs, including inclusive recruitment practices, how they can calculate gender pay and best practice in terms of inclusion. I would point to a really good example, which ties in nicely, I think, with a number of the conversations we've had this morning, and that is Barclays and the new campus that they have opened up in the south of Glasgow city centre. So that was an area of land that was lying vacant for a number of years. And through our colleagues in Scottish Development International, we worked comprehensively with Barclays to secure one of their main investment hubs into Glasgow. We were competing internationally with, I think, seven other countries for that, and actually other countries that could provide a lower cost solution. But the quality of the workforce here in Scotland won that business. So not only did we, as a consequence of support, which is up to £14 million from Scottish Enterprise, not only did we secure that facility in Glasgow and safeguard 1,800 jobs, there's the potential to create up to 1,400 jobs more. But key to the discussions we were having with Barclays was around their inclusion policy, and they were very focused, or they are very focused, on recruiting from people with disabilities, veterans, so very much an inclusive approach to their recruitment, and indeed we built that into our grant conditions.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, certainly here you're talking about the policies of the inclusion, diversity, and the like. But so my question is really: have you actually done any economic assessment of what the opportunities are being missed by not including these groups, and therefore then a strategy behind that to actually unlock those economic opportunities?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay, thank you. No further questions.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to thank the panel for their contributions this morning, and that's been much appreciated. I will now briefly suspend while we change over the witness panel. Thank you. Now, I'd like to welcome our second panel this morning. Craig Isles, Service Lead in Planning and Building Standards at South Ayrshire Council, and Craig is joining us virtually. Bill Lindsay, Service Manager, Policy in Place and Planning Services with Fife Council, and Steve Rogers, Head of Economy and Development, Dumfries and Galloway Council. Welcome. And as before, if members and witnesses can keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, that will help us get through this morning's business. If I could maybe ask an initial opening question, I'll start with Steve. During this inquiry, we are hearing about certain issues within planning that maybe presents challenges for redevelopment of town centres. As we've been interested, do you think there's enough flexibility within the planning system that enables and supports the regeneration and investment within our town centres? And maybe could you also maybe comment a bit on, we've heard about pressures within planning departments, about a lack of capacity or additional pressures there. Can you comment on that as well? And the desk will operate your mic, okay. Mr. Rogers.
Thanks, and morning, everyone. I'll try and take the first part of that question initially around the role that planning can play in terms of town centres and encouraging and promoting town centre development, and also whether there are any issues or constraints that maybe hinder that. I think maybe before I go into a bit more detail on that, the specifics, I think there's a wider point that I would want to make, which is around the way in which planning is part of a much, much wider toolkit that's available to public bodies and agencies to try to address and tackle and promote issues within town centres. So certainly, I don't think the planning system has got all of the answers to these challenges. And I think the key really is the way in which the planning system supports and interacts with a lot of these other tools that are available to us. So from that point of view, the planning system as an enabler, I think, has developed very strong approaches in recent years to supporting town centre development, and I can point certainly to our own local development plan, LDP2, which has got some specific policies. ED5 is one of the policies that very specifically encourages and promotes and supports town centre development. There are inevitably challenges in terms of the actual delivery of development within town centres, especially within historic town centres, challenges associated with maintaining the kind of the character and the historic appeal of town centres. There may be challenges around ground conditions that mean that there are extraordinary development costs associated with redeveloping town centre sites. There may be challenges around flooding, for example, and issues that we sometimes need to overcome in terms of dealing with SEPA or other statutory agencies who maybe have got their own particular priorities and agendas. And we've certainly had a few of experience of that in terms of trying to promote and encourage reuse of buildings within the town centre. But I think generally the planning environment and the planning policy environment is very supportive and encouraging of town centre development. I don't think the lack of investment and development in town centres is necessarily a reflection on the planning system. I think it's really a reflection of a lot of the wider issues around how to actually deliver town centre development, how to fund town centre development, and how to overcome a lot of the challenges around town centre development. Most developers prefer to choose easier to deliver locations and easier to deliver sites, and that is part of the role of the planning system, is to try to direct development towards maybe those more difficult sites, but recognising that that does bring with it certain challenges.
Mm-hmm. Can I maybe, just because we're a bit pressed for time, I'll maybe pass over to Bill and see if Bill has anything additional to add, and if you maybe want to comment about capacity within planning departments.
Thank you and good morning. In terms of the capacity issue, first of all, I would touch on some of the points Steve was making, in as much as this is a multi-agency, multi-council service approach. So yes, there are pressures on planning services, planning departments across the country. Those are well recorded. But the approach to town centres is so broad that planning is part of the solution. So it might not necessarily be an issue in terms of addressing town centre issues and their future as far as resources within planning departments and services are concerned. There might be issues around possible changes to PD rights and what that might trigger in terms of particular workload and work streams for development management colleagues. But as a development plan-led policy approach to town centres, that's one part. So just to touch on the point Steve is making, that's a multi-agency approach. So pressures are probably spread. In my view, it's not just solely planning departments. In terms of the flexibility, I think that's a really interesting point, because if I think local development plans produced even 5 years ago didn't anticipate where we are now. We've got a global pandemic, we've got into a second recession in about 12 years or so, and now the effect of a major European conflict, none of that was predicted. These are plans that were meant to be looking ahead 5 to 10 years. Mm-hmm. None of this could be predicted. And we're in the same position now. The new round of local development plans to be prepared under the new Act cannot possibly anticipate everything that's going to happen. So flexibility in the planning system, I think, will come through policy, come through planning policy. They're used in a quasi-legal way due to their statutory status. That's inevitable. That's part of the development management system. But they need to balance certainty in terms of making planning decision with avoiding the unintentional consequences, perhaps, of blocking something we might want to see happen. And that flexibility, I think, has been shown over the last couple of years. I can touch on examples separately if you want, but just as a kind of overview to address your issue about flexibility, I'll leave it at that just now, but happy to follow up.
Thank you. And Mr. Isles, is there anything additional you would want to add? One of the things we've heard during the inquiry is sometimes frustration around, you know, the planning will be restricted because of noise levels or these other conditions. I mean, it is the case that, as Mr. Lindsay had said, some of this is statutory and it's not possible for planners to make decisions that are counter to what the statutory position is.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Just in terms of the couple of points, capacity of the service, I think there is a national crisis in terms of planners coming into the system. I believe there's only two universities in Scotland that do the planning courses. There is a shortage across the country in regards to that, and we're working hard to try and bring through graduates ourselves, grow our own in terms of that. And that is obviously with the staff retiring off the other end of the conveyor belt from there. So there's definitely challenges there that we need more planners in the system coming through the universities. In terms of the flexibility of the planning system itself, I would suggest that the policies are there to be able to be flexible enough to allow development to go ahead. And I don't think that's necessarily any policies in our LDPs that we would say if we just took that out or ignored that policy, everything would be fine from there. I think the key issue really is that it's about the viability of the development industry, the property industry in terms of round about the town centres. And there's a great parallel here, I think, to the vacant and derelict land issues for industrial land, where they are constrained by, you know, contamination issues in old buildings. And I think town centres are in danger of falling into a very similar scenario, where we have shop units which are costly to convert into anything else, you know, particularly moving them over into housing. And you've got multiple ownership issues which make it complicated. And each of the units are of a size that make it very difficult for any builder of a scale to go in and actually decide to try and do anything with those properties. Everything is dealt with in a very a small piecemeal element of it. And I would suggest that it's the industry that requires the support rather than the challenges from the planning side in terms of what we can do. We try and be as flexible as possible to allow the right sort of development in our town centres, but they're not necessarily being brought through because of the financial side. They're businesses, they need to make a profit. They're looking at these schemes and they're not seeing them as viable in terms of delivering enough money, which is why they're not coming forward, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Isles. Now, Mr. Isles, you're not here as a VAT expert, so if you don't know the answer to this, it's. I understand it's zero VAT for new builds, but is there? I thought there was maybe a rebate for commercial buildings into residential. Is that?
I'm not aware of that, so I wouldn't be able to comment on that.
That's
it's certainly a fact. Anything that financially helped would take things forward.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you very much. Colin Smith to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Can I turn to the issue that's been raised, I think, very extensively with the committee, and that's the challenge of derelict buildings in our town centres. The committee visited the Mid-Steeple Quarter in Dumfries recently. It coincided, I think, on the day that a certain street in the town was closed because a building was deemed to be dangerous. A building that had been derelict for some years become so dangerous that the street had to be closed off. And Craig won't need me to tell him about a certain building in the centre of Ayr, the former Station Hotel, which again was closed because of the danger, and that disrupted rail services in the town for months. So something has clearly gone wrong when it comes to the action that we're able to take to stop buildings in our town centres falling into such a state of disrepair. So can I ask the panel, maybe starting with yourself, Mr. Rogers, can I ask, what do you think has gone wrong? Is it because councils don't have the powers, they don't have the funding, or are councils too slow to use powers at an early stage to avoid town centre buildings getting to the point where they are being closed because of them being dangerous and all the disruption that goes with that?
Yeah, thanks very much. There's a number of different dimensions to that. First of all, in terms of powers, there are a whole range of statutory powers available. However, they do tend to focus on crisis situations. So the example that you've just referred to there in English Street in Dumfries, which I believe the committee visited and experienced the inconvenience of the associated road closure. So that was necessitated through the building standards system, where that building had become so derelict that it was now creating a danger to the public, and on further inspection it was actually at risk of collapse in part, and working eventually managing to work with the owner to take responsibility, because I think that's one of the key things that and this is a challenge that we always face, is that the responsibility for the maintenance and upkeep of buildings is the owner's. And it's only in situations where the owners are failing to take that responsibility that public bodies are able to step in and ensure that public safety, for example, is not being compromised. So that was the process that we followed there, through engaging with the owner and eventually using our statutory powers and cooperating with the owner to facilitate the demolition of that building, which we accepted was the only solution to secure public safety in that situation. What that doesn't do is address issues of which are probably more commonplace than that, which is issues where buildings have fallen into disrepair and have become unsightly, and essentially a blot on the townscape. And we do have various powers available to us there through listed building legislation and planning legislation. But again, it's always trying to strike that balance between trying to work with owners and encouraging building owners and property owners to take the responsibility. And I think that's where perhaps the resources issue also comes in, because I think what we need to have and make sure that we have available to us is a range of positive incentives rather than just focusing on the big stick approach, so that we're able to offer support and help to address, you know, some of those issues that, that Craig was mentioning about viability. One of the reasons that people don't invest in the buildings is because they can't make a return on it. And that's particularly the case in some of our rural communities where we have essentially low demand and low values, low property values that don't generate the financial returns that you might get in, you know, in the likes of Edinburgh, for example. So there has to be a role to play for public sector in terms of either providing gap finance or providing some other incentives and incentivising building owners and developers and investors to start to invest in town centres. So one example of that that we've put into place is our Town Centre Living Fund. So every year the council has determined that it will set aside £1 million from our second homes council tax income and use that as a fund to support town centre living projects. And over the course of the last 5 years, we've supported a number of RSLs as well as private landlords to invest in the either new builds property or refurbishment of existing properties in order to make them available to support the supply of affordable housing in town centres. So that's one example where probably more could be done to actually incentivise investment and perhaps having to resort to using those enforcement powers would be the last resort.
Just on we've heard about the living fund before. It's obviously a good idea, and it's having a huge benefit. But can I just ask, Mr. Lindsay, do you think the powers go far enough at the moment? So Mr. Rogers talked about you can take action when a building's basically dangerous, but actually when there are trees growing through the windows, or the windows are not even there for that matter, there's not a great deal, it sounds to me, that you can actually do about it unless it's a listed building. Would that be fair, and do you think the powers should be strengthened?
The powers are probably sufficient. Mm-hmm. But again, it's come down to the resources to be able to implement them and follow through, in my opinion. Similar issues come up in the local government housing and planning committee's hearings into draft NPF4, where there was also discussion around derelict and vacant land. And these are the same sort of discussions that were coming up. So again, there are resources issues around the funding to follow through, perhaps the personnel to follow through.
The council's reluctant to use the powers because you just, frankly, once you start, it's going to start to really draw on your resources.
It will vary across the country, but if there's no capacity there to do a piece of work, and Mr. Rogers had talked about enforcement. Enforcement officers across the country have been diminishing over the years, and they're dealing with everything from unauthorised felling of trees through to some serious breaches of use in buildings. So there are, I think the powers are there. It's having, as in many discussions we have, having the resources in terms of finance and personnel to follow through.
Okay. And can I ask, Mr. Lies, obviously the high-profile case of the Station Hotel in Ayr is an example of a very absent landlord. I mean, you know, it's all very well to talk about working with landlords, but if the landlord's not willing, then how do you actually make sure that action is being taken?
For me to talk specifically about the Station Hotel, given it's a live case and ongoing just now, but in generality, I think there are definitely challenges where we have either, as you said, an absentee landlord, an owner of a building, or whether we have people who are show no interest or have no financial ability to be able to actually engage in the process. And it does present us with the situation where the council has got limited powers, and I think I probably disagree with some of my colleagues that the expectation of the powers is greater than what the powers themselves actually are, I think, is probably what I would like to say there. Under the actions that the council takes in South Ayrshire in the particular case we're talking about, was under the Building Scotland Act, and that was about making the building safe and preventing the danger. But that's as far as you can go. You can't go and actually go in and do any more than that. You then have to move into other legislation. And from the planning legislation, if you're wishing to take work on either that building or any other building, you then have to be able to demonstrate that you actually have a plan of what you're actually going to do going forward and that it's in the public interest. You also have to be able to demonstrate that you're able to pay for the proposals that you are bringing forward. So you can't just acquire a building because it's in a poor state of repair unless you have a clear plan to be able to follow that through and be able to demonstrate that to the court and to the due process for the compulsory purchase as you go forward. It does become a very complicated process where you actually have to almost front load the whole system to be able to demonstrate what you intend to do with that piece of land or that building at the end of the day, before you can then start the compulsory purchase process. And you also have to be demonstrating that you actually have the funds in place for it. So it becomes a very complex situation there in relation to how the council can take that forward. As my colleagues here were saying, there is obviously issues in terms of resource and expertise and being able to take some of these matters forward and working with the, we try our best to work with the property owners in all circumstances to deliver the solutions on it, but quite often these people are, you know, they're either absentee landlords like that, or they're investment funds who have got no interest in the property other than just being a line in a balance sheet somewhere. It makes it very difficult to engage with it because they're not, generally speaking, they're not sort of locals with an interest in the town and want to see a betterment in the town. They're actually, you know, just have it as an investment opportunity, shall we say.
So how would you change those powers? Then you say that there's a need to maybe look at those powers as well as obviously the resource issue, but how would you change those powers?
Yeah, I think, you know, across the board, we tend to focus on these big buildings, you know, whether it's in Dumfries or in Ayr or in Kilmarnock or whatever. But our town centres are, you know, full of lots of small buildings which are in poor state of repair. You know, the former butchers and things that have got shops above them that are units above them that are drawing the streets, generally speaking, down into a lower standard than we'd like. And I would like to sort of see if it was possible some sort of local development company opportunity set up, something like that. And I think there was reference in the New Future for Scotland's Town Centres document about a strategic acquisition fund, something along those lines where councils can actually get a body together where we can draw and have funding available there to be able to go to landowners and actually look to acquire the properties or assist them in doing betterment for their properties in line with a greater master plan. In fact, you know, the three of us are planners here. We like to see these things planned out in a proper manner to take it forward. But some sort of master planning approach to that, which allows a strategic view of your street, how you're going to develop it, how you join up your as I say, in the smaller scale stuff where you have the butcher whose shop is shut down, they still get the unit but can't do anything with it because it's too expensive to convert it over into a residential unit, along with the chap upstairs who's got the one bedroom flat that he bought as a small return for a private let situation. How do you join them together so that we can actually get a reasonable conversion of that into, say, a townhouse? You know, and if you can do that and replicate that along your streets, you then start to bring people back into those areas and you get it joined up. At the moment, there's no connection between these people. And there's also situations where the properties are just vacated and, you know, and they fall into people who have perhaps died, and then it falls to relatives who have no interest in it, and it's just a debt to them. And then the councils are trying to follow those matters through. And we see it from the building standards side, where we go after, we're looking at the dangerous buildings for chimneys and such like, which are commonplace for those problems. And you sort of do that paper chase and you find that there's various multiple owners of, you know, relatively small buildings. And when you start to scale that up to larger buildings, it becomes very difficult to coordinate it. And it's beyond, back to the resources question of earlier on, beyond the resources that we have at the moment. We've basically got, you know, teams that deal with plan applications, teams that deal with local development plan production. We don't have teams in there that can go and do that research and acquisition and that sort of master planning. And I think that, for me, an area where the real benefit, if we get powers around about that side, you can then start to see from there. And again, it ties back into, as I mentioned earlier on, you know, vacant industrial land. You know, there's reasons there why that isn't brought forward, and sometimes that's due to land acquisition and different people not wanting to work together, as well as contamination issues, which are the sort of blight of those areas. Thanks.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, convener. I wanted to ask you about change of use and the classification system for, you know, Class 1 shops, Class 7 hotels, etc. When we had a visit to Dumfries, we were shown a number of examples in the high street. One was a men's retailer shop that was closed and was wanting to be converted into a restaurant, but the local development plan has the main street as all Class 1. And we saw another couple of units that had lain empty for 20 plus years, if the information that we were given was correct. And I'm just wondering if in this rapidly changing situation, where we've got the pandemic, we want to bring in 20-minute neighbourhoods, we've got e-commerce, is the classification system flexible enough to accommodate change of use, and are there any changes that are required in the system itself? And since I mentioned Dumfries, I better come to you, Steve, first.
Sure, thank you. First off, the planning policy in the town centre was changed some 4 or 5 years ago. So what you've just described is, if you like, the traditional approach that used to be taken to planning policy in town centres, where you would have what was usually referred to as like a core retail zone, where there were certainly restrictions in place to basically protect the core retail offer of the town centre. However, when we reviewed that 5 years ago, when we were producing the current local development plan, LDP2, members were keen, and we were keen, to get that changed and introduce a lot more flexibility. So that whole retail protection zone has gone, and we now have a much more flexible policy which encourages and promotes different uses and different mixes of uses within the town centre. The main caveat, two main caveats, first of all, uses that will add to the vitality of the town centre, and secondly, uses that are not going to introduce an amenity issue for existing residents. But subject to those, then, and I think possibly when you were visiting the high street, you might have noticed that there are more cafes, restaurants now in the high street than there ever used to be, which was a consequence of that stricter regime that used to be in place, but that absolutely has been changed.
So given that you are encouraging more mixed use, is there a need for a general town centre use classification that would cover some of these classes, so you wouldn't need to apply for planning permission to change the use?
It's certainly an interesting proposal, and I'm aware that is out for consultation at the moment. Mm-hmm. I have a view that the use classes order itself is out of date, and when you look at the classifications, they do relate to the economy as it used to be 20, 30 years ago, mm-hmm. and probably the time is right for an overhaul of all of the classifications. Whether it's a good idea to introduce a town centre use is another matter, because what you're trying to do there is to introduce a spatial element into something which is only intended to determine whether planning permission is needed for a use change anywhere. So there could be unintended consequences from taking that approach, because I'm not sure I understand how you could limit it to high streets or designated town centres. In other words, there would be situations out with town centres, in neighbourhood centres, in villages, in smaller communities, where the ability to lose for the village shop, for example, to suddenly change to being a hot food takeaway could actually introduce a whole lot of new problems and issues into that community. So that could be an unintended consequence. So I would say that we need to think long and hard, and I would prefer the onus to be on a complete overhaul of the actual use classes system.
Okay. Bill, is there anything you would like to see change in the classification system?
No, I'd underline the point that Steve's made about the unintended consequences, and if you're changing the use classes, it's going to apply everywhere. It's not just going to be to town centres. So you need to make that distinguish, I suppose, between the what use class order is for, mm-hmm. and what permitted development rights would be there for. Identifying where planning permissions is not needed, as opposed to the planning policy-led approach, mm-hmm. which will be identify a facilitating and enabling mechanism to encourage and promote what we would like to see happen. And I go back to my earlier point about we don't necessarily know what will happen in the future, but it'd be the policy needs to be flexible enough to allow change to happen. That might involve requiring planning permission, and so be it. So that's just the nature of it. I think there is the unintended consequences are opening up perhaps amenity issues to introducing problems into an area. And if we look at another aim and objective of both NPF and the wider discussions around town centres about reintroducing a resident population, many benefits and advantages in that, but it does bring with it problems and potential conflicts. So I think we have to be quite careful about this. And I would, Steve's right, this use class order was written in an entirely different age, but we shouldn't rush into these changes. I think we have to look at the whole package as a whole, as a package, rather than just individual parts of it.
Okay. And Steve, Craig, if these use class orders were written for a different age 20 years ago, what changes would you like to see happen to them?
I don't know. I haven't given that a consideration. I think the guys are right that there's a need for them, and I think we need to make sure they're applicable across the range of the communities that we have, not just as our larger high streets, but they are suitable for the towns and the villages that we've got, because that's where the challenges can come in as well, where there's close proximity to residential units, and that's one of the things we need to make sure we protect from there. But no, off the top of my head, I can't think of any significant change that I would look for them in terms of just maybe an updating of them in terms of how they're brought forward.
So the other point I was wanting to ask was about building standards. Clearly, designed to promote sustainable development and protect the public, but are there any aspects of the building standards system that need to be changed to encourage redevelopment of our town centres? And I'll come to you, Craig, first.
No, I think the system's in good shape, and it's a very rigorous thing which is required to ensure that we actually deliver the sustainable goals. And I think if we start to try and water it down in any way to facilitate development, then it's going in the wrong direction from there. So I think it's what we do require on the building standards side is actually resource. There's a distinct shortage in terms of surveyors coming through the universities and colleges to be coming in to service all of the councils. And I know that's one of the challenges that we do have the labs that they're working on just now. But in terms of the overall process, I think it's a sound process, and I think it's vital to protect consumers as well, that we have that in place and that people get what they're expecting at the end of the day. And to drive forward that net zero aim, the regulations are very good at doing that, as well as issues such as accessibility, which are vital to ensure all members of our communities can actually get about, which is an important thing from there. And I think that's something that can sometimes be seen by developers as not necessarily a higher priority, and that's where the regulations are vital to be able to ensure that those things are brought forward.
Bill, is there anything that needs to change in building standards?
Not anything that I've considered and want to put to the committee. Just that that point about in terms of sustainability, it's a building, probably building standards more than planning can deliver that, because it's black and white. You meet a standard or you don't. Planning policy is too open and flexible that way. It's hard to deliver and implement. So I've got nothing really to add specifically on building standards.
Steve.
Yeah, thanks. I think the issue really is partly around the application of the system, and in order to support particularly some of the challenges within town centres, reuse of upper floors, for example, conversions of older buildings, require probably a flexible approach to be adopted. So, yes, there are regulations and building standards to be followed, but I think there also needs to be an element of discretion involved and flexibility to ensure that they're being applied in a proportionate fashion, so that they don't act as a barrier to that kind of safe redevelopment and reuse of older buildings in town centres. I think it is. I think it's there in the system at the moment. There is that opportunity. In some circumstances for flexibilities to be applied, which is why I was suggesting that it really comes down to how you approach and how you implement the current system rather than necessarily having to make any legislative or statutory changes.
Right. Thanks very much.
Maggie Chapman, before by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, Claire. And good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for your comments so far. Bill, you've spoken a couple of times about flexibility in planning policy and both the need for it, but the problems potentially that some of that flexibility can cause in not directing enough or not being directive enough. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are around the town centre first principle. I know it's a principle rather than a specific policy, but that principle is designed to support town centre development and regeneration, and yet we still see planning departments giving permission to out-of-town developments that take social and economic capital away from town centres. Can you comment on that?
First thing, so you see planning authorities giving consent to out-of-town centres, not planning departments. There is a strong and consistent thread of planning policy supporting town centres first. Our Fife's current local development plan was possibly the first just around to produce a town centre first policy, so it clearly advocates and promotes that. The difficulty is always going to be on implementation. For the reasons we've heard already, we've heard from Steve and from Craig that there are development economics and viability issues that come into this. We also have a situation where the older model, and it now seems quite an aged model of retailing, has continued to promote out-of-town locations because they will rest on an argument that that's what the customers want, that's what the consumers wanted, and there has been an employment benefit in some areas as well. So it's quite a difficult issue. Elected members have to juggle all of these things and decide whether they're going to stick with the recommendation or otherwise. But in terms of the town centre first principle, I think it's something we should be sticking to. We should be promoting it because it's first port of call. If we've learned anything over the last couple of years, that people started to hear the term rediscover local. Now, it might not be a local in terms of having the same major stores or the same size of operation, the same mix in your high streets. And all high streets are different. All town centres, different sizes, neighbourhoods within cities, etc. They're all entirely different. But I think it's finding something which works for those individual locations so you can promote and encourage local businesses and entrepreneurship, local services, attract people back into town centres where they have the upper floor spaces vacant just now and boarded up for financial reasons, etc. Mm-hmm. Where you have people in, you have activity, where you have activity, there is opportunity for services and businesses to be created. And I think you also provide a much healthier environment and more attractive environment. But that's part of that's only one of the steps to get there. There's so many other things involved. Town Centre First isn't just a planning policy. Mm-hmm. It has to be something which is agreed and managed through economic development, through working with, I would say, even working across the council services and community planning partners. So we have health services in vacant shop units, for example. We were talking about 20-minute neighbourhoods. Let's start from the centre. Mm-hmm. Let's start from where many people would go to congregate for a series of activities. A lot of these activities no longer exist because of the changes we've had in recent years, structural economics changes, etc. But there's an opportunity to try and reverse that.
OK, thanks. And you said, in answer to another question earlier, about one of the roles that you have is to facilitate and enable the implementation of the vision that you're wanting to see. I suppose that really follows on from that point then. How do we make sure that the vision for the town centre, taking account of the town centre first principle, actually does pull in all the connections and, you know, pull in all the resources? How do we make sure that those processes are actually supported and sustained to create the blueprint, if you like, for the town centre that actually does provide a livable space for everyone?
That involves that wider corporate and interagency working. Mm-hmm. It requires money. It requires money. Some of it will be public sector to pump prime and take the initial risk and steps where the private sector then can come in and invest. So you've got some leverage in there. It takes an approach where economic development agencies, housing agencies are involved to identify opportunities within town centres. Again, something other authorities are looking at as well, but certainly Fife is looking at that mm-hmm. opportunity to do so. But again, there are resource implications in there, because where you have people, you also need the services. Services will be attracted some cases because of there's an attractive proposition there. There's a client base or a customer base for commercial activities to come in. But for other services, there has to be that sort of more planned investment to make sure that public services are available and social services as well. So it's all going to come back to resources, both from the private sector and the public sector, to deliver this.
OK, thanks, Bill. Steve, could I come to you? In one of your earlier answers, you talked also about the focus of the local development plan being, you know, having a town centre regeneration development sort of principle at its heart. How can we make sure that actually is sustained in decision making, in planning, mm-hmm. and in that kind of visioning that we've been talking about?
So just to come back on one of the points that you made there in terms of the application of planning policy, mm-hmm. and what's happened in the past around out of town retail. So don't take this the wrong way, but we have historically tried to resist, mm-hmm. but been overturned on appeal by the Scottish Government Reporters Unit. So two of the three developments in Dumfries were as a result of planning appeals. And that, I think, emphasises the need to have a really robust policy framework that is resilient and capable of resisting development pressures in inappropriate locations. My concern about the draft MPF4 is that it doesn't quite do that. I don't think that the policy wording that's been put forward currently is robust enough to withstand planning appeals and potentially court of session processes. So I think that's something that and certainly I think the Heads of Planning Scotland have kind of reached out to Scottish Government to say it would be good to have some practitioner input to the refinement of those policies. I think the policy intent is very good. However, how that is translated into actual robust policy wording is another matter, and there's an art to it. And I think that needs some further input from some colleagues to help with that. Having said that, the role that planning policy can play, I think, is evidenced in our current local development plan. I mentioned the policy that we have around encouraging and promoting town centre uses and mixed-use development and other uses within town centres. But in order to support that, we've also got another policy, ED6, in our LDP, which requires a sequential testing approach. So when developers come forward with development proposals that are out with the town centre, they have to evidence that they have gone through a sequential test, starting with the town centre and then working their way to edge of centre and finally out of centre. So they have to evidence that there is no other suitable site or no other suitable location for their development before their proposal will even be considered. So that's a really important way in which the town centre first principle can actually be put into practice. Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons I'm mentioning that is that it was quite recently put to a fairly intense examination when we had a situation in Dumfries where Next wished to relocate from the town centre out to one of the retail parks that has a restriction attached to it, limiting it to the sale of, you know, kind of bulky goods, white goods, electrical goods, but expressly prohibiting retail activity. Mm-hmm. And the owner of the retail park was extremely keen to attract Next to come and locate there. So their application to have that condition lifted was refused by us. We required them to go through that sequential test, and obviously they found it quite hard to discount Next's current store in the town centre. However, that went through appeal. We were supported on appeal, and it then went to the Court of Session, where again we were supported. So that policy actually helped to prevent that out-of-town drift that you're talking mm-hmm. about. So it's really important that those policies are robust enough to withstand those kind of judicial and quasi-judicial processes.
Thanks, Steve. That's really helpful. That example, I think, is a really good example. Craig, if I can come to you. You've spoken about working with landlords, working with developers, and I'm wondering whether one of the missing pieces in some of this is direct engagement and work with communities themselves who either want to be or are already in town centres to ensure that there is better understanding of things like town centre first principles. So you know, the policy points that have already been made notwithstanding, there can actually be delivery on that.
Yeah, I think obviously the communities are a really important part of what we do, and we try and engage with them wherever we can and bring them into all these decision-making processes. The key thing for driving this forward is they'll have their ideas of what they want from it, and whether it's through perhaps local place plans as they're coming in, where they'll cover those town centres and the varying levels of what they see for it. But for me, there's an element here where we need to actually change what our town centres are and how we can actually get people into them. And I think something that hasn't been mentioned is the sustainable transport and being able to get people into the communities and actually get them into the hearts of their town centres, which will then encourage your retailers to try and stay there, because that's where people want to go, because they've got a good public transport system, which will take them into the heart of their community rather than jump in their car and go to the out-of-town centre elements. And by drawing more communities into these and setting them up with those plans, I think is an important thing to help them shape what is wanted from their areas. And also that, back to the points of compulsory purchase we touched on earlier, as part of that, you need to be able to demonstrate that you have a final plan for the building that you wish to purchase, you know, compulsory purchase. So being able to do that and generate that head of steam, if you like, behind that project and trying to get funding is vital to have the communities on board, because they're through different channels that are now available to them, may be able to go and get additional funding that are available to councils to carry some of these schemes forward. So it's really important for us to ensure we engage with, you know, the community councils and the communities on a different level as well, because not everybody's involved in their community councils. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's really important. Thanks.
And Sorry, of course. Thanks.
I do have three members left wishing to ask questions. So if I ask people to be brief and as direct as possible in their questions and answers, that would be helpful. Colin Beattie to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thank you, Vena. I've got a couple of areas I'd just like to explore a little bit with the panel. We're all familiar with the term agent of change and the principle that's behind that. Do you think there's been any significant change or effect on town centre development as a result of that concept? And I'll ask Craig to come in first on that. You're on mute.
Town centres has been...
It's resolved now, Mr.
This time is not my fault, convener. Somebody else is controlling me. I think that the changes which have taken place in our 10 centres have been as a result of the changes to all our methods of shopping and how we have changed that, and it's not been sustainable for these units to be sustained in those areas, and that's why we're getting all these vacant units within our town centres. From there, and I would say that's the biggest agent of change that's impacted on the communities from there. Hopefully that answers your picture, right?
I mean, as I understand it, the principle of agent of change is that if there is a development within a town centre, whoever is the principal mover in that is responsible for mitigating any aspects that might impact on the public, for example, noise and so on. Have we had any negative... has it had any impact on town centre regeneration?
I haven't seen anything coming through the system as yet that would be able to demonstrate that. But I would think the majority of retail units or whatever coming into town centres are not going to have a significant impact on those existing users. Where you have nightclubs or whatever, they may have that factor from there, but I'm not sure how many of those and how much difference they would actually make to the town centres. But I would suggest that for the majority of things coming in, is not going to have a change, but it's not something I've had to come across a great deal of experience of at the moment.
Steve, have you got a view on this?
I think that currently we're in a position where there isn't a huge amount of development interest or proposals coming forward within our town centres. Most of the town centre development activity, certainly in very recent years, has actually largely been driven by RSLs, who tend, in my experience, to already have those wider community outlooks in any event, in the way that they conduct their business. So any issues that arise from the development of affordable housing within some of our town centres have been addressed through the use of planning conditions or Section 75 agreements, working with RSLs. So I don't have a great deal of experience of developers or private sector developers and any issues that, similar to ones that you've flagged up there.
Bill, have you had any experience in your area of this?
I'm not familiar with any experience or any particular examples. I would say, however, it's a relatively new term, but it's something which has applied for years. Many years ago, when I worked in this city, just along the road from us here, we had an area of quite established, just before Meadowbank, an area of established industrial use when flats were first introduced in there. It's the same issue. What's the impact of introducing residential premises or residential developments within areas where they might be affected by long-established businesses? It's the same principle here. We've got a real balancing act to try and... achieve here for town centres, and I think particularly cities as well, perhaps more than town centres. I may be wrong in that, but where we're trying to create a nighttime economy, a vibrancy, at the same time as bringing people back in, there will be those conflicts. They have to be, excuse me, they have to be addressed and considered quite carefully. We also have to understand the what are the expectations of people who are moving into particularly established town centres where there's a lot of activity and noise which they might find detrimental to their living standards. We find this, and it does just apply to town centres. We see the same thing applying in the countryside. People moved into the countryside and finding that the hens and cows are mooing at early hours in the morning, disturbing their sleep. These are not at all unusual. They're planning amenity issues. But for town centres, they're particularly acute because we're trying to achieve quite a number of things in relatively small areas. So I don't have any examples to quote, but I think a lot of the potential issues are there to be seen, and maybe brings us back into how we're going to deal with a sort of policy-led approach to changing our town centres and how they're going to be in the future.
Your responses have been informative on that. Can I just move into a slightly different angle now? During COVID, there was obviously a big change in working practices, and there was a huge increase in home and hybrid working. Now, that's sort of continued, hasn't it? We haven't gone back to fully being in the offices again. Consequently, there's going to be an impact on our high streets, if only from the sandwich shops, from the little retailers that we'd have staff popping in from time to time. What might this mean for future planning policy? How might this impact on future planning policy? And again, I'll come back to you, Craig.
I think there's two elements to this. There's the work that people are doing at home, and how that impacts on their neighbours and what they're actually doing, the activity that they've got in their street, whether it's people running a business from home more and more, which is becoming much more acceptable from there in the activities you see. I think in terms of the high streets themselves, I think they will evolve. I think with people working from home, you may see that it has been reported that people are rediscovering their local towns and areas where previously they were commuters. They were just jumping on a train and going somewhere else. They're now discovering their own communities. And if that could be embellished further and built upon, then we are back to building good local communities. And if you can get people sustaining the local shops, that might be a positive from there. So while it may have a detrimental impact on your high streets and your principal shopping areas, there's potential that it could actually improve your smaller villages and your more rural residential areas where you have shopping parades and such like, which are getting more support because people are just popping down the local shops to get things rather than elsewhere. And now planning policies would need to reflect that as we go forward. And I think the flexibility that we've spoken of all morning about for the town centres is vital to that, and being able to get people in and out. And I bring it back to touch on earlier, that sustainable transport. We can get people in and out of towns on electric buses or whatever easily, then they will go and use that if it's convenient to them from there, and that will drive that that whole agenda, which in turn I think will have an impact on the out-of-town areas. If they can be seen that the town centres are places where people can happily jump on a bus and get to town centres, then the retailers will come back to those areas because they'll see them as where people want to spend their money rather than in their cars.
I suppose one of the difficulties here is if you're looking ahead, you don't actually know whether home working and hybrid working is going to continue at what level. So it's a bit difficult if you're in the planning side to sort of look ahead on that. Steve, would you like to...
Sorry, Craig, were you coming back in?
So I was just going to say, if the councils are anything to judge by, many councils are pushing towards hybrid and home working and agile in order to reduce their zero carbon agenda to bridge that forward. So if that mirrors with elsewhere, then I think you will sort of look to plan for that as we go forward. Thank you.
Steve.
I think this is possibly likely to have more impact on cities and city centres, which are focal points for a wide range of office activity. What I would say from my perspective in Dumfries and Galloway is that We need to be careful not to make too many assumptions here, because if you look at the staff within my service, within the council, for example, 80% of them have continued to work frontline, not in offices, right the way through the pandemic. So we're talking about a minority of our staff that are actually office-based. All the folk that are delivering frontline services, whether it's emptying bins, whether it's keeping our streets and our parks and our urban areas clean and safe, they have all been out there working right the way through, and that will continue. So any impact of the move towards home working or hybrid working needs to be seen in that context. We're only talking about a minority of, certainly from council's point of view, it's only a minority of staff that are able to do that and are going to be doing that into the future. So the impact on our town centres is relatively limited. I would also suggest that there's actually a positive here, which is that for once the location, which has traditionally been seen as a disadvantage of places like Dumfries and Galloway, has suddenly become an advantage and a selling point. And what we are seeing is people relocating, because one of the consequences of being able to work remotely from anywhere is that you could be sitting in somewhere, you know, like Castle Douglas or Gatehouse of Fleet, or in the countryside down in southwest Scotland, and working for a company based in London or Manchester or Edinburgh. And we are seeing increasing examples of people doing that. And that in itself actually is a boost to some of our communities and to some of our towns and villages, because they're bringing in new activity, they're bringing in visitors, and they're bringing in disposable income. Whether the flexibilities are there in our planning policies to sustain that is something I think that we need to look at through MPF4 and the review of future LDPs. But I'm pretty sure that the policies are already in place to support home working. I think the other point to make is that we're already seeing the development industry responding and reacting to those changes, because when you now look at show houses, for example, they inevitably contain an additional room or a study that's been set aside for home working. So these things are already being adopted and built into future developments by the house building industry, for example. So I think the flexibilities are already there.
Thank you. Okay. I do have to make some progress. I do have two members left and we are running out of time. So Fiona Hislop to be followed by Alexander Burnett.
It is still good morning. So National Planning Framework 4 encourages town centre living, including the reuse of vacant upper floors of commercial property and redevelopment of redundant retail units. So I think this will probably have to be quite brief, but how have your authorities worked to support such development? And is there anything the Scottish Government can do to help support such properties for housing? And it might be helpful if you can give us a sense of how much of your high street, for example, has vacant upper properties. We're very conscious of that from our Dumfries visit. But maybe if I can come to Bill first, if you can give a reply to that.
Okay, in terms of practical work that's taken place, the Fife Council has a well-established and affordable housing programme. The latest phase of that includes promoting town centre living. Again, it comes back to resources, making sure that's viable, that works, that we can work with owners who can see a sense in cooperating with the council or with other housing agencies to deliver that housing. It brings with it, though, the issues I mentioned earlier on about the supporting services that are required. And through our review of our local outcome improvement plan, I would expect to see there more of a discussion in line with that. So we're speaking with the health services and we've got education support to try and sort of bolster the opportunity for residential accommodation. Opportunities are really, we've got a long list of sites, but actually finding sites which are ready to deliver and can be achieved in the short term are quite few and far between without the need for additional funding. So that would be the resources.
So it's funding and policy.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And Craig, is there anything from South Ayrshire on that?
No, I don't think. I think that the council is always looking to try and develop in the town centre and try and bring people back into it. But there's no specifics I could bring to answering that question. And just in terms of your question of how many units, I'm afraid I don't have that figure available from there. Sorry about that.
Anything from you, Steve?
It depends how long we've got, because there's quite a lot that I could talk about, but I'll be brief. I'm conscious of the time. I think, first of all, having a look at the way in which RSLs are funded to deliver difficult to develop sites, including reuse of vacant and empty properties. I think there needs to be certainly a weighting and a gearing towards the way in which the funding of those developments is currently supported. We're certainly finding where we are having to use the place-based investment programme, for example, as well as our own town centre living fund, just to try to help RSLs make some of those difficult sites deliverable. So that's one aspect. I mean, the other one that I was going to mention is, and you've seen for yourself firsthand, the work of the Mid-Steeple Quarter. So we've been working very closely with the Mid-Steeple Quarter to help them to develop that master plan for that part of the town centre, which includes a good high street frontage. So as part of that work, when you look at their master plan document itself in terms of what they're trying to achieve, there were four residents in our high street when they prepared that, and they have a target of, I think, increasing that to something like 66 or 70 as a result of their development. But what we're hoping is that once people appreciate and once developers understand what can be achieved in town centres by applying that kind of master plan approach, that there will be other developments, particularly from RSLs, coming forward to help address some of those issues that you've mentioned.
So if there's anything practical you can, suggestions after this that you want to let us know about, please do, all three of you. And then just finally, with local place plans being important for community involvement in supporting town centre regeneration, what do you provide just now and what could you provide additionally to communities? Because yes, you're experts in terms of your profession, but the communities are expert in their local place. So how do you make the most of that and give them the skills and the expertise they need to realise their own expertise about their own communities? So maybe again, Bill and then Craig, and I'll keep to the convener of how much we can go on this. Bill.
Okay, briefly on that, the last week we opened an invitation to community bodies to consider preparing local place plans. We have a website already established with FA frequently asked questions and some advice and pointing towards resources. One of the points we're making here is that because the communities are preparing this, they will need resources. We are not in a position necessarily to provide all the resources and support they would need, because they're going to be community-led place plans, but we can provide signposts to the information they need. We're also working through our Fife is seven areas for community planning purposes. Each of those are reviewing their local neighbourhood plans, local community plans, for want of a better term. And that involves, again, gathering information on what their community, how they see their communities. So all of that will feed into their work as well. My role over the next year will be to prepare a new local development plan, which we've saying quite openly just now, it's going to be place-based. So we have to tap into that information. Mm-hmm. As you say, the people who know their place best are the people who live there. So we want to try and tap into that and see what we can do. National Planning Policy 4 sets of policies. We shouldn't have to repeat that. What we want to do there is look from the ground up and see how we tie into that and synchronise both the policy and the place-based approach.
And Craig, is there anything additional to what Bill said?
Yeah, just in addition to that, I would suggest that resource is the key thing for us to be able to support the communities. I think for local place plans, the better off areas will quite happily prepare their own local place plans. Mm-hmm. They'll have retired professionals who will happily be involved in that process. It's those communities who are aren't as well resourced within there that are going to need the support, and that's where the council, I think, will need to support them without trying to lead them too much, because, yeah, as you say, it is their plans that are meant to be coming forward.
And Steve, is that more community development, do you think, it might be needed for support, not just access to planning offices, etc.?
I think it's about capacity building and capability building within the community, and that's certainly something that we're working on at the moment. We have started a programme using the... we're part of the Borderlands Inclusive Growth Deal. So within the Borderlands Deal, there is a place programme, and in delivering that place programme, we've started work in across five different communities in Dumfries and Galloway to help facilitate them to prepare place plans. Right. And one of the benefits of doing it through the Borderlands process is that ultimately those place plans can generate investment in projects within those places. So there is a tangible end result and end product. And what we're trying to be careful to do is to align that with the new approach in the planning system with LPPs, so that these place plans are also capable of being adopted as LPPs, because it's really important principle that there should only be one plan for one place.
That's very helpful. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Convener. Just very briefly, and maybe just to Steve, if you'd be able to answer. I just wonder, is converting unused commercial property in town centres into new homes commercially attractive and technically possible? And secondly, do you have any challenges with identifying owners or complex ownership structures of unused buildings?
The answer to the second question first is simple. Yes, there are a lot of challenges in terms of identifying absentee landlords and property owners, and that can take up a large amount of resource, because that has to always be the first port of call, is to ensure that they are held to account for their ownership of that property. In terms of commercial development viability, I think it's been many, many years since we've seen any evidence of particularly commercial house building activity anywhere near our town centres. The challenge is really around some of the extraordinary development costs that are often associated with trying to redevelop town centre sites. How that can be overcome by the private sector alone, I think, is very challenging, given their driver has to remain making a return on their investment. However, I still believe that there is a continued role for the public sector in terms of gap funding in particular to support that development, if we're trying to achieve wider societal benefits from those investments, then that's something that I think arguably would support continued public investment in providing that sort of gap funding.
Thank you. Just very, very briefly then, on the second point of identifying ownership, do you have any solutions there, or do you see where the fault might lie?
I'm not sure I have any specific solutions. I would like to see progress made with, I think, one of the proposals that was floated in the, I think, in the previous town centres review was around compulsory sales orders, and that might be something that might help address some of the other issues that the committee has raised this morning, but I'm not sure it addresses the specific issue about tracing tracing absentee landowners.
Yeah. Thank you. Unless the others want to come in, I have no further questions.
Mr. Ellis, do you wish to comment on this at all?
No, I would just agree with Steve that it's very difficult to trace the owners of these buildings, especially when they get into companies which are offshore and such like. That can be like very challenging.
Mm-hmm. Can I just ask a final question? Apologies if you've already addressed this, but there's a number of areas where councils can carry out work and then reclaim the work from the owner. Is there, on paper that sounds very simple, is that actually at times, do you know how many times that is difficult to recoup expenses that council have paid out in terms of defective properties, etc.?
Steve, do you want to?
You're absolutely right, and that we do that by, you know, there is a default power there available to us. We have used it, particularly in situations with dangerous buildings where, you know, frankly, we can't stand by and watch just for the sake of mm-hmm. having to spend money in order to address a public safety issue. So we do have examples where we have, in the absence of an owner and the absence of cooperation of an owner, we have entered premises and either carried out partial demolitions or boardings up and made premises safe, and then tried to, and that's probably the main emphasis there, is tried to recoup the outlay from the property owner. But as you can appreciate, there's a whole debt recovery process that then has to be mm-hmm. followed, ultimately ending up in the courts, but also taking out charging orders is another way in which we can try to at least get some security over the premises that we've been into.
Mm-hmm. So it would be the case that the council would really only take on the work if it was a public safety. It would have to reach that point because there's uncertainty being able to recoup the funds and to have the land, the owner be responsible.
No, I don't think it would be fair to say it's only in public safety cases, because I'm talking there mainly about the building standards enforcement system. So in the planning enforcement system, again, if there are situations where, for example, there is a non-compliance with a planning condition or there is a breach of planning controls, then depending on having a proportionate view about the damage and impact that that is causing to the wider public, then we do also have those same default powers to go in and carry out works and ultimately seek recovery of those costs from the owner.
OK, thank you. I'd like to thank all three witnesses for their contribution this morning. I will now close the meeting as we move into private session.